In 1939, when I came into the world, I was met by a man called my father. My father was a strong man. He was an Indian. He was a hunter, and my father was a fisherman. And my father always wanted his firstborn son to be like him, that one day I might inherit his legacy. But as I came into my father's world, his hopes quickly diminished when he looked at me in anger. For my father noticed three things about me. He noticed I had only half a nose hanging on the left-hand side of my face. Then my father noticed I had no upper lip. And when my father looked for the third time, he noticed a huge hole in the top of my mouth. And in 1939 in North Dakota, we knew very little about severe cleft palate conditions. In fact, the doctor who came from the valley into our log cabin in the hills, he looked at me, he threw up his hands, and he whispered to my father, "You send him away. He doesn't belong in the valley community. He'll never learn like other children. He'll never speak like other children. You send him away." My father didn't know what to do. He was a proud man. He wanted me to be everything he had hoped that one day I might become. And so my father began running away. And as my father ran away, he ran into a world that we now fashionably call the world of alcoholism, a world that my father almost never came back from. And for years, I grew up wondering why. My mother didn't know what to do that night either, but she told me years later, she pulled the blanket over her head, she put her arms around me, and she hung on to me. She didn't want to lose me. But people from the valley heard from the doctor about the freak child born in the hills, and they came into our log cabin. They took me away from my mother, put me in a small hospital when they really didn't know what to do, so they pulled the left-hand part of my nose over to the right-hand side of my face, leaving me with a very flat nose for many, many years. They tried to repair my upper lip, and if you look carefully tonight, you'll notice they did a very crude job. And then for 17 years, they did absolutely nothing about the hole in the top of my mouth. And Macaroni at Midnight will tell you what it feels like on the inside to grow up for 17 years, not being able to speak clearly, having a flat nose, being Indian, and not being wanted in the community. I can talk tonight about the feelings, but as I stand before you, I know that my family do not want me to share Macaroni at Midnight. I understand that. In fact, my own brother tried to kill me before a public appearance. I understand that. And some of the memories I'll share tonight, educators may not want to hear. I understand that. But the memories are mine. And the memories are real. I can talk tonight about the first 9 years of my life. Those were the crucial years. And as I grew up in the hills, I watched my father run away, wondering why he could never put his arms around me, why he could never hold me, why he could never look at me with pride, why he ran and ran into that world that I could never understand. And then I wondered why he and my mother had such a hard time accepting me, why he blamed her, and then she blamed him. They said ugly things one to another. There were times in those 9 years when I used to wonder who my real father might me. And that hurt. And then I began wondering about the other pain in my life. The pain of being lonely in my home. The pain in here from a severe heart condition, a hole in my heart, still there tonight. And then the pain in my legs that never went away. Now we call it rheumatic fever. And then there was a pain in my stomach that my family don't want me to share. A pain that made my muscles pull in and it made them tight. And now we have a fashionable name for that. We call it the pain of malnutrition. The pain of hunger. The pain of poverty. 9 years wondering why. And in those 9 years, I wanted to learn about the world around me. And one day, against my father's wishes, I went down into the valley part way. And as I went down into the valley, I came upon an isolated area. And in that area that we now call the city dump ground, I used to sit and watch people from the valley come and throw away food. I couldn't believe it. And I'd take the food and push it down that hole, never had me chew it. It all went down that hole automatically. And then the pain went away momentarily. And then I'd watch other people from the valley come and throw away clothing. And I'd put the clothing on me and I'd feel warm momentarily. But the real reason for going into that isolated area is that there I met the first friends I ever knew, and they were the rats. And I remember running and jumping and playing with the rats, pretending they were my friends. They never laughed at me. They never pointed fingers at me. They'd run with me and jump. I could pretend that they liked me. They were my friends. But then at nighttime, I began learning something about rats. At nighttime, they go back into the ground, and they don't come out till morning. I can't tell you tonight how many times I sat waiting, wanting my friends to come out and want me. Always wanting somebody real to want me. 9 years of wondering why. When I was 9 years old, a man came from the valley into the hills. He was an important man. He had a long title. I didn't know what it meant then, I do now. He was the superintendent of the public school, and he came into our log cabin, and I heard him say to my parents, "He's 9 years old. You send him down into the valley. We don't know how to teach him. We're not sure we can help him talk, but you send him." My father said no. He was ashamed of me. But one day my mother pushed me out the door, and tonight I'm glad she did. And as she pushed me out the door, I went down into the valley. And as I went onto the playground of public school, I began learning how to be lonely and have people all around me. For as I walked onto the playground, children came running, looking at me out of curiosity, and then they began telling me things I already knew. Things like, "You can't talk. You can't talk. Flat nose, flat nose. You can't talk. Smelly engine. Smelly engine." And that hurt. But then they began chanting words that I could never understand then. Words like, "Donald Duck, say quack quack. Donald Duck, say quack quack. Donald Duck, say quack quack." And I remember putting my hands on my ears and running away, but the word followed me all the way home. And that night I couldn't tell my parents what happened. And as I tossed and turned in my bed, shutting my eyes, putting my hands on my ears, those words came at me all night long, from all sides to me. All I could hear was, "Donald Duck, Donald, not. Donald, not. Say. What? What? I never wanted to be Donald Duck. And I never wanted to go back to public school ever again. But my mother pushed me out the door unknowingly. And on the second day when I returned, children came up running around me, looking at me, laughing at me, mimicking me. And then one child ran by, grabbed my hair, threw me up against the wall. Another child hit me, one hit me. And what took me over 30 years to talk about was a child who ran by and actually spit all over my face. I didn't know what to do. And I ran into the classroom. And as I ran into the classroom, I found a desk. I put my hands on it. I hung on. And then I heard the teacher saying to another teacher, "Why in my room? Why? They say he can't learn. He can't talk. He's Indian. Why in my room?" And like the hope for my father, my hope began diminishing. But I hung on, and when the children came in the classroom, when they poked me with their pencils, when they hit me with their knees, when they took my papers, one after another, and ripped them in front of me, I hung on until finally one day, out of her frustration, I understand it now, the teacher took me and put me in that little room. I'll never forget it. And as she put me in that little room, I heard what sounded like a nail going in the hook on the outside of the door. And as I spent time locked in that little room, away from the other children, I began living in two psychological worlds. In one world, you've already heard, I wanted them to want me. I wanted them to like me. I wanted to learn how to speak. I wanted to learn more. I already knew how to read. I could spell and print quite well, but they assumed because I couldn't speak, I could not learn, but I wanted to. And when that didn't happen, then I moved into the other world that even tonight I have trouble talking about. And in that other world, I remember thinking, if I had my father's knife, they won't laugh at me tomorrow. For when they laugh at me, I'll hurt them. And if that doesn't work, I'll run home and get my father's rifle. I'll run back to the village. And when they laugh at me tomorrow, I'll pull the trigger, and I'll pull the trigger, and they'll never laugh at me again. I can't tell you tonight how many times I wanted to eliminate all the laughter around me. I never went through the second grade. Teacher didn't want me. First grade teacher wouldn't have me back for another year, so they got together and they simply promoted me to the third grade. Now, fellow educators, when that happens, a child becomes even more frustrated when the teacher is trying to explain that long word called electricity, and I can't write down the answer. I've never been around it. We don't have it in a log cabin. I couldn't understand it. I fell behind, and then the children laughed more, calling me names like dumb, stupid. And the word that haunted me for years, mental, mental, you can't learn, mental, mental. I want to share with you tonight, I was never mentally retarded for a moment in my life. But because I could not speak, they assumed. and they labeled me. In fact, if I were to share with you tonight my IQ, you wouldn't believe it, because for many years, I never knew I had one. Year after year. Let me not talk anymore about academics, for they spent so much time undermining my potentiality. I began learning that academics were secondary to affective experiences. Let me share one that had an impact on my life for years. Walking home one day after school, a small group of children asked me to go on a walk. And as we went into the hills, I noticed that they were whispering about me. And then I noticed that one boy had some rope in a back pocket. And then I noticed that the rope went around my hands behind my back. And then I noticed that each child came with the help of a closed fist. They began hitting me and hitting me until the blood ran down on my shirt. You need to remember my shirt. And as the blood ran down on the shirt, I wondered, how will I remove it? How can I untie my hands? I couldn't. When an old man came walking through the hills, he untied the rope and set me free. And as I walked home in my freedom, the educators could never understand. The superintendent would never know, because they never came into my home. They never came into my world. They never came into my culture. And as I walked home, I tried to remove the blood, and then I tried to hide it from my father as I walked into my home. And as I walked into my home, my father saw the blood. I could not explain to him. And in his anger, my father took me and, like the children in the village, he threw me. And then my father kicked me. And then my father began hitting me over and over and over. And in my heart, I began hating the man who brought me into the world. And in my hate, in my hurt, I went into another world. And as I went into the world with juvenile delinquency, I became one of the most effective juvenile delinquents my hometown will ever remember. And as I moved into that world, I began running away until one night I could run no further. They threw me in jail, and as they were going to send me away, a man walked in the back door of City Hall, and I heard him say to the judge, "Don't send him away. That boy is my son." I'd never heard that before. They sent me home with my father. I really wasn't sure I wanted to go home with him, but as I walked home with my father, I began thinking, everything will change. He's walking with me, side by side. What every child in America wants is an adult walking with him, side by side. My father won't change. He called me his son. And as we walked into our home, my father took me, and again in his hurt, he hurt me in such a way that I can't share with you. But that night I went to the wall. I took the rifle. And as I aimed the rifle at the man called my father, I remember thinking as a child, "You told them you helped me. But you never helped me. You hurt me, and you hurt me, and I hate you." And as I went to pull the trigger, my mother ran and hit me on the face. I dropped the rifle, but I never dropped my intention one day to kill my father. And at that moment in my life, a woman from down in the valley came into my world and completely changed the world around me. And as she ran away from that Indian reservation in North Dakota, she ran many, many miles through a small white community 3 miles from Canada.
And there she met a very tall Native American man, a man who came from a home of poverty, family violence, alcoholism, child abuse. And as they met, my father, who came from a family of 10 children, my mother from a family of 15, they wanted to honor that Native American tradition. They wanted many, many children. And eventually they had 10, but I happened to be the firstborn child to my mother and father. And as I came into the world on that cold December night, my mother and father could not wait to have their firstborn child. My father wanted a son to be just like him. My father was a hunter, a fisherman, an athlete. He could run like no man had ever run before. Proud man. And he wanted me to be just like him. I never became like my father. For as I came into the world, as my father helped my mother to deliver me in that one-room log cabin, my father looked at me, and all the hope he ever had for me to be like him vanished at that moment when he saw my face. I had only half a nose. I had no upper lip, and in the top of my mouth was a huge hole, what we now call a severe cleft palate disability. But in 1939 in North Dakota, we knew practically nothing about my disability. And my mother and father were living up in the hills away from that small white community. And they had no money. They had very little food, almost no clothing, a one-room shack. They were poor. They were poor. And as my father put me down, my father turned away from me and he told my mother, "That is not my son." And then my father made a choice. And that choice affected the baby for many, many years. My father ran away. He would not look at me. He would not hold me. He could not love a handicapped child. My father did not know God. My father never went to church. But as he ran away, he left my mother and me all alone in that one-room shack. My mother knew not what to do, but she valued life, and she wanted a family, so she hung on to me tightly. And when the doctor came up into the hills, when the doctor looked at my face, when the doctor threw up his hands and told my mother, "He'll never talk. He'll never learn. Send him away and let him die." My mother wouldn't do that. She valued life. And as she held on to me, the doctor became angry. He went back into that small white community where they had 7 churches. And he told the people, "I was a freak, handicapped Indian baby." And when the white people, when the 7 churches found out I was Indian, not out of compassion, but out of racial prejudice, they came up into the hills. They took me away from my mother, and they sent me 22 miles to a small rural hospital. They did not care about my mother's feelings. My mother told me years later, she cried and she wept and she was all alone. And in that hospital, according to the medical records, I lay in a bed for several weeks without any medical intervention. I was Indian. We were not valued then. But one day a young university medical student saw me, and he wondered why they had done nothing to my face. And as he demanded that they help me, they took the left-hand part of my nose, they pulled me over to the right-hand side of my face, leaving me with a very flat nose for 17 years of my life. They pulled my upper lip together, but they did nothing with that hole in the top of my mouth. And when that young, white medical student demanded that they return me to my mother, I went back to that one-room shack up in the hills of North Dakota. And I hate to share this with you, but for 9 years, I grew up in a world of loneliness, hunger, poverty, and my mother hanging on to me, wanting me to survive, and the seven churches did nothing. And as I began growing, my mother always wondered why I became so hyperactive, hyperkinetic, and now we know when alcohol is involved and you're pregnant, the baby becomes damaged, and I had become damaged. Now we call it fetal alcohol syndrome. I could not control my hyperactivity, my nervousness, my crying, but my mother, and I remember as I grew older, she was always hanging on to me, loving me. And my father was never there. 9 years. I remember my mother running down in the river and coming back with a pail of water and dropping the water down that hole so her child might survive. I remember my mother coming home late at night when all of the white people were sleeping and my mother had stolen food that we might eat. And the seven churches remained silent and uninvolved. 9 years. And as a young child one day, the pain in my stomach was so hurtful from the hunger, I went looking for food. And as I walked into that small white community of seven churches, I remember going to an area near the railroad tracks. Now they call it the city dump ground. And in the dump ground, when I saw the white people throwing away food, I remember picking up the food with my hands and pushing it down that hole, and I did not know how to chew my food then. I remember putting on the warm clothing I found in the dump ground. And I'll never forget as a child, wanting to be warm, wanting to be wanted, wanting to have a father, wanting to have a real family. And when my mother found me playing with the rats, my mother became angry. And out of her love for me, out of her concern for her child, my mother took me by the hand and brought me into that small white community. And there she took me to a small elementary school run by a church. And when the church saw my face, when they saw the color of my skin, they told my mother in front of me, "We will not allow him in." And out of her frustration, my mother took me further into that community to an elementary public school where my people were not welcome. She left me on the playground. I'll never forget that moment. And my mother went back to our log cabin in the hills. I was alone. And the children gathered around me, looking at me, laughing at me, pointing fingers at my flat nose, calling me names I did not recognize, like Donald Duck. Say, quack, quack. you can't talk. Da dun da, da dun da. And I remember how that hurt my feelings. And when that young girl spit all over my face, when I ran into the school looking for a teacher, putting my hands on the desk, holding on in fear, when the children picked up their pencil, poking me in the back, pulling my hair, making me cry. I remember out of the corner of my eye, I saw this woman walk into the room. She took me by my shoulders. She locked me in a closet, the first teacher I ever had. And I learned years later, she went to one of the seven churches religiously. My second grade teacher would not allow me in her classroom, so they put me in the third grade. I couldn't talk, I couldn't read, I didn't know how to write. And in the third grade, my teacher told the children I was mentally retarded. And they gathered around me one day. They took me up into the hills. They tied my hand behind my back to a tree. And what we now call bullying, they hit me in the face until I felt the blood run down on my shirt. Frightened, overwhelmed with fear. But they ran away, laughing. They never told anyone. My mother went looking for me, could not find me. And late that night, up in the hills of North Dakota, an old man who had a long beard and long hair, dressed all in black, from a Hutterite community in Canada, 3 miles away. Why he was walking in the hills, I couldn't understand then, I do now. But he found me, and he untied the rope and told me gently, "Run home, I'll watch you." And as I ran home, blood all over me, a very tall man was waiting for me. My mother told me he was my father. Now, a full-term alcoholic, an angry man, a violent man. When I could not talk, my father took me, and my Native American family, even today, hate me, and now I can talk and tell you, my father threw me, my father kicked me, my father hit me, and as my mother tried to intervene, as a mother would do, she became a victim of my father's anger. I'll never forget that moment. As my father threw her into a window, and I heard her yelling for help. Not knowing what to do, I ran away. I ran into that small white community, breaking into the church, looking for refuge, hoping somebody would help me, and no one would. Breaking into the home, stealing food and money, wanting to be warm, always wanting to be warm. Going down to the roller skating rink, breaking into the rink, and surviving on chocolate candy bars night after night after night. But one night I made a bad choice. I went back to the elementary school and broke into a window, went into the library and picked up a book, and I wanted to read, I wanted to learn. And I fell asleep that night, lonely, hungry, holding a book, never thinking my life would change dramatically that morning. My hometown, the seven churches do not want you to know. And when I awakened the next morning, two white policemen standing over me, taking me by my hair, locking me in the trunk of their automobile. We call that racism today. And as they took me to the local jail, what they don't want me to talk about now, I remember as a child watching the two policemen drinking the alcohol, and then I began making the connection that white people and Native American people, when they abuse alcohol, the same thing happens. Their emotions become damaged. And I recall that night, lying in a cell, and the two policemen came in and removing my clothing, what some people call police brutality, I call sexual abuse. And the pain is overwhelming. You live with that pain 24 hours a day. And you think about ending your life. And then the world of hate becomes a new reality for that child. I began to hate my handicap. I began wishing I were not Indian. I began to hate my alcoholic father. I began to hate white people. And the child began thinking that one day he will kill all of the people who hurt him. We need to understand our children. And we don't understand the child. We may always wonder why the adult became the person he might become. My father came after me. My father was drunk. I understand it now. But as a young child, black and blue marks all over me, not able to tell my father what had happened to me, my father took me home and locked the door of our one-room shack, removed a large leather belt. And as he hit me repeatedly, when he threw me on the floor, I could not handle the fear and the hurt. And as I crawled over to the wall, I took my father's rifle. And what happened to a young Indian boy 9 years ago on that reservation in Minnesota, bullying and rejecting, growing up in a world of hurt and hate. He murdered 9 people, including his own family members. I understand him. I wanted to do that. And as I aimed the rifle at my father, my mother ran up to me and knocked the rifle out of my hands. And then my mother told me what children don't understand. My mother told me, you must not kill, you must not hate. One day we'll be a family. One day we'll have food. Hear me, church, a child doesn't understand that kind of hope. I only knew hate. I never thought my life would ever change. I remember thinking so many times, going down to the river, standing up on the bridge, and what I couldn't understand then, I do today. Every time I went to jump, it seemed like a pair of arms surrounded me, and I couldn't jump, but I wanted to. And I'm here this morning only because of one person. I want you to know her. I hope you'll never forget her. We're making a movie about her and me. I wrote a book about this woman. Macaroni at Midnight tells the story of that one woman. She was not Native American. She never had a handicapped child. She never lived in poverty. She never grew up in a one-room shack. She was never bullied. Her parents were from Norway. Wealthy, wealthy people. And when this white woman heard about the Indian boy who could not talk, out of her compassion, out of her concern, but most important of all, out of her faith, she took a risk. And I learned from her that we in the church, we have to take a risk. She walked into my world when I was 12 years old. I hated white people. And as she walked into my life, what no one had ever done, she put her hand on mine tenderly, compassionately, lovingly, without any condition. And I would not look at her. I was afraid of her. And as I moved away from her, her hand remained on mine. And as she walked with me, I tried desperately to pull my hand away, and she hung on to my hand and telling me gently, "Don't be afraid of me. I'll not hurt you." I could not trust anyone white. And as I continued trying to separate myself from this white woman, I looked into her face. I want to share with you this morning. I'll never forget that moment. She had a tender smile. Her eyes were so overwhelming to me, filled with love. And with her hand on mine, she told me, "If you help me wash my automobile, I'll pay you a quarter, and you may come into my home and eat my food." I knew that wasn't true. My people weren't allowed in a white man's home. We weren't allowed in church. And as I tried to walk away, she told me again, "Help me, and I'll help you." And as I looked into her face, I began to trust the white woman, wanting to believe her. And as she showed me how to wash her automobile 4 times in 1 afternoon, I hated her immediately. But she paid me a quarter If you ever come to my home in North Canton, Ohio today, and you're all welcome, not at the same time, in my office today, at this moment, I'm 75 years old, but there's a quarter on my desk. I want to remember her. I want to remember her love. And I want that quarter to challenge me every moment of my life. As I raise my children, I look at that quarter. The child never forgets the impact. But more important than the quarter, she welcomed me into her home. And as I walked into her home, a child out of poverty, it was like walking into your church this morning, overwhelming, electric lights, a piano, a fireplace, carpeting on the floor, warm, warm, warm. And then I saw the table. It took me years to write about her table in the dining room, filled with food, orange juice, milk, all kinds of food. This morning, the hospitality woman, not knowing me, she said, "Oh, take all you want." She had no idea. The white woman told me that. And she told the movie producer right before she died, "Oh, he was hungry. 7 helpings of all of my food. I never thought she would ever feed me again." But the next morning, I remember so well. I rang the doorbell, 4 o'clock in the morning. She came to the door, her hair all a mess, in a nightgown. She told me, "Come in, I have more food." She taught me how to wash her windows, how to vacuum her floors, how to make more corners, how to take my corners and buy clothing for the first time in my life. And when I push the food down that hole, this woman of faith took her hand, wealthy, white, prominent, and put her hand in my mouth. And at the age of 12, I learned from her how to move my tongue for the first time in my life. She taught me how to hold a fork, how to put the food in between my teeth, how to chew my food. Church, hear me. She had everything. And yet, she invested her life in my need. It was the white woman who taught me how to read, who taught me how to write, who taught me how to work, who taught me how to take a shower. In the movie, we have a scene, my favorite one, where she sends me into her shower where I'd never been before. And I come out as a 12-year-old Indian child living in the world of poverty. Now I have all my clothes on, my shoes on, shampoo and soap all over me. And the white woman said tenderly, "My, my, my, we have a lot to learn." This morning, in the privacy of my home, before I came here, taking a shower appropriately, I remember her. Every time I have a meal, I remember her. it was the white woman who took me back to the public school, and I hate to share this with you. I respect teachers today, but as a child, I could not. It was a teacher who told the white woman in front of me, "You're wasting your time. He'll never be able to talk." And so Macaroni at Midnight became the story of this wealthy, white, prominent, faithful woman with a husband on my nose, with a mirror under my nose, with a radio and tape recorder, and her food all around me, motivating me, challenging me, believing in me, loving me. And for many, many years, hear me, church, for many, many years, and one night, she looked at her watch, and she said, my, it's very late. You must run home and show your mother and father what you're learning. I didn't want to. I ran home around the midnight hour. My mother had a hot bowl of macaroni waiting for me. And when I picked up my fork, when I put the macaroni at midnight in between my teeth, for the first time in my childhood, I saw my father watching me. And as I chewed the macaroni, he asked my mother, "How?" And my mother told my father, "Abraham, the white woman in the village, she tells me he'll be able to talk one day." And so I put my tongue in the right place. I made the air come through my lips. I remembered everything the white woman taught me, and that night I made a sound. And as my parents heard me, wanting to speak, they went to the white woman. And what the county commissioners would not pay for, what the medical people said would never happen, what the public school did not want to do, the white woman, on her own, began changing my life forever. She took me to many, many hospitals. She learned all about my handicap. I had 17 major surgeries on my face. And because of her investment and involvement and unconditional love, I want to share with you this morning. I have a whole new face. A nose made out of plastic material, and I tell children all over the world I don't have any feeling in it, but it looks real and I kind of like it. They made me a new upper lip. They gave me new teeth. And then at the age of 17, they put a round steel plate in the top of my mouth. And then the woman told me what I did not want to hear. She said, "Don, now you must go to a special place for therapy." I wrote her a note, "No way." And the white woman said, "Fine, no more of my food." I went in the program. 6 years in a row, she came and saw me. She brought me food, showing me unconditional love. 6 years as I struggled to learn how to talk in the way I now speak. And as I went back to that small community, here's what the church ought to be. She found employment for my father. She found housing for our family with electric lights, running water, and linoleum on the floor. She found employment for me in her grocery store. And as I went back into the public school, I wrote a whole chapter about my high school teachers. They were phenomenal. They helped me to learn. My best friend in the world yet today shook my hand and nominated me to become the first Indian president of my high school class. I became a leader, I became a learner, and through the help of that white woman, on my graduation night, she walked into the front row with my mother. My mother wore a dress that the white woman had gotten for her, the only new dress my mother ever owned. And they held hands when they heard the superintendent announce that I would become the first handicapped Native American student ever to graduate valedictorian of my high school class. When the white woman made me mad, she said, "Don Bartlett, I think you can learn more. You must go to the university." And with my new voice, I told her, "No way." And the white woman told me, "No food." I went to 3 universities. I have a chapter in my book called "Oatmeal from Canada." She mailed me food. She wrote me letters. She came to see me, encouraging me, believing in me. That is the church. And I made it professionally and academically. Became a social worker, a counselor, and an educator. 25 years working with minority children, handicapped children, poor children. However, what I don't want to share with you, as I left my childhood in that small community, I tried to leave behind me all the hurt and all the hate. And I'm here to tell you this morning, you cannot run away from it. And so like my father, I made a choice, a bad choice. And as I became an alcohol abuser, the anger and the hurt and the hate emanated from my childhood. And at the university, when I met a beautiful white student, I took her into my life. I took her into my cobweb, and today she's no longer alive. She died an alcoholic. And I ran away. I ran away. And in 1964, I ran all the way to California, long hair, red bandana, anger oozing out of me, alcohol overwhelming me. And at the 1964 Republican presidential campaign, there's a clip of me on television showing me shouting out anger. And when I came face to face with the wife of the Republican presidential candidate, I spit all over her face. And Mrs. Goldwater asked me, "Why? I don't know you. I've done nothing to hurt you." I remember telling her, "You have no idea how your people hurt me." And as I ran all the way to Michigan, there I met another white woman. I wish she'd be here this morning. She's in California helping to care for a brand new grandbaby. But they know her. Pastor and Jan know her. And like the white woman in my childhood, when she came into my life, she knew nothing about me. And I wouldn't tell her about the hurt and the hate and the pain. And for 6 years, my wife and me wondered why I was misusing alcohol, why I would hurt her. And one day, like the white woman had done in my childhood, the white woman had always opened a book. She called it a Bible. And when I was a young boy, I remember her telling me about having a heavenly father, and he had a son named Jesus. And as I remember her always reading her book and closing her eyes and then helping me more, now this white woman that I had met, who came from a very wealthy, prominent General Motors family, that's why I married her. I wanted the money. I wanted the power. And I thought if I marry white, nobody will ever know I'm Native American. And when my grandfather died, we went back to North Dakota. My wife met the white woman. She met my mother. She learned all about my childhood. And on the way back to Michigan, my wife opened the Bible. And my wife told me, "Don, I know you hurt on the inside. Now I know why. But in the Bible, there are three little words in Matthew 7:7, ask, seek, and knock. And as my wife told me that, I said, oh, I've heard that before. The white woman, she told me I had a hem. She told me, Matthew, I remember that. And that night, Julie, my wife today, challenged me to become a born-again believer. She invited me to a church. And just like this morning, hear me. Don't ever change. The people in that church, they just put their arms around me, welcoming me. They never even noticed my disability. They did not care about my skin being brown. They welcomed me. The fellowship was overwhelming. They invited me into their home. And I remember the white woman showing me the same love, and through the fellowship of that church. One night, the pastor, that's why I love your pastor so much, he got up in the pulpit and he opened the Bible. I thought he was looking right at me. He said, "Tonight, I want to preach on three little words in Matthew 7:7. And on my way home, I opened the window of my car and I cried out, "God, if you are my heavenly father, if you're real, I want Jesus Christ in my heart." And at that moment, September 30th, 1974, 8:38 p.m., Jesus Christ became real to me. And as I went home, asking my wife to forgive me, she challenged me even more. She said, "Don, in the Bible, Luke 23:34, you can learn how to forgive." And as I went back to North Dakota, as a new man in Christ, wanting to turn over a new leaf, I had to share that. I began forgiving all the people in my childhood. Church, hear me. I would not be here this morning. I would not have a testimony if I had not forgiven even the two policemen. I do not hate them. I went back to them and I forgave them. And as I went on the radio in 1981, by the invitation of Dr. Dobson, 91 million people heard me share my testimony. And as I was sharing about my father, Dr. Dobson had the audacity to write me a note. We were on the radio, so nobody would ever know. He said, "Don, pray for your father." And I went, "Dr. Dobson, Don, pray now." And as I bowed my heart on the radio, as I began praying for my earthly father, church, you need to know what happened. In North Dakota, in the same hospital where I had my first operation, my father lay dying. I did not know that. I was on the radio in California. The doctor heard my speech impediment. And when Dr. Dobson announced me and Don Bartlett, the doctor went into my father's room and he told my father, "Your son is on the radio sharing his faith and praying for you." My father told the doctor, "What does that mean?" And as I prayed for my father, the doctor led him to the Lord. And so this morning, I want to share with you, it was Dr. Dobson and my wife who challenged me to forgive the one person I hated the most. This morning, I miss my father a lot. I think about him often. I have 7 daughters and 1 son, and they love me. They love their father. I want to challenge you this morning to be the church at home, at work, at church. When they interviewed the white woman right before her death, the movie producer told her in front of me, "Mrs. Barta, you came from wealth. You were prominent. Why? Why would you help Don Martin?" And this white woman to offer glasses, and she told the movie producer, "When I was 12 years old, my father put me on his lap. And my father told me, 'Beulah, we are very wealthy. We have much money, but Beulah, in the Bible, in Luke 12:48, I want you to remember Beulah." And when I was 12 years old, Beulah met me, and Beulah remembered her father challenging her from Luke 12:48, "To whom much is given, of him is much required." She never forgot that. That's what motivated her when she met me. And then the movie producer said, but Mrs. Barta, I need to know more. Why would that motivate you?" And Mrs. Barta said, "Oh my, let me share the Bible with you." Can you imagine sharing the Word of God with a movie producer? She did. And this is what she shared. I'll never forget her. I was sitting in the corner, and the movie producer told me, "Don't say one word. I want her to tell me your story. I have to be sure your story and her story are the same." Church. She told the movie producer more than I did. He was shocked. And then she said, in Matthew 25:35-40, young man, this is what we read. "For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in jail, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we ever see you hungry? When did we feed you? When did we give you drink? When were you a stranger? When did we invite you in? When did we ever clothe you? When did we see you in jail and come to you? And the King, Lord God Almighty, answers, truly, I say to you, to the extent that you did it to one of these brothers of mine, even the least of them, you have done it to me. Everywhere I go, all over the world, on the airplane, in my hotel room, as I walk alone many, many times, I take my childhood with me. This morning, I want you to meet my mother and father. The year is 1939. And when I saw my baby picture for the first time in my life, when I was 21 years old, then God revealed in me why my father ran away. My mother, in front of the one-room shack, always loving me, telling me, one day you'll talk. And as the saliva ran down the front of my shirt, my mother loved me unconditionally. I want you to meet the white woman. Her jacket is pure silk, cotton, wool from Norway, eh? You can smell the wealth, but you need to look in her eyes. And you need to remember the tender, gentle smile of the church. And then this morning, seven daughters and one son. We have 31 members of our family today. We have a multiracial, a multicultural, a multi-economic, and even a multi-political family. Not happy about that. We have a Jewish son-in-law. We have an African-American Mennonite son-in-law. God has a sense of humor. We have a Native American son-in-law. And all my other in-laws are just plain old generic white folk. We love them all. 17 grandchildren, all because one woman showed me what the church ought to represent. Will you bow your heart while I pray? In his time, in his time, he makes all things beautiful. In his time, Lord, my life I bring to you, and may everything I do only serve to honor you. In your time, Amen.
Amen.
When I asked the white woman right before her death why I was so important to her, she told me something about the church I had never realized before. And right before she died, she told me she had a very lonely marriage. She had a husband who never practice Christianity. And her daughter grew up idolizing her father. And out of the loneliness of her family life, she found me to love and challenge and to tell me about Jesus. And I began learning so late in life that even when we're hurting, even when we're lonely, we can minister. The Bible says, out of our affliction, we grow strong. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.